Okay, so you was asking, what's your name?
Zaid.
My name's Ali. How you doing? Okay, so you had a question.
Yeah, my question is do you believe religion or like religious guidelines should change with time or alter according to society's beliefs?
So the question that you asked here is basically, can the religion of Islam change with the times? Yeah? So now the way we answer this, because the question that's being asked, obviously you're here, you were learning off each other, yeah? What this question does is it negates, it's a matter of tawheed. It negates Allah's sifat, asma wa sifat, his names and his attributes. So what it does is to say that Islam is time bound means that when Allah legislated it, that either he did not know, yeah, or he was wrong.
That's true.
Yeah? So now we don't affirm wrongness, yeah, even when it comes to attributes of Allah, we don't affirm words that have a negative connotation to it. Yeah? So that's the reason why we believe Allah will never make a mistake. And we believe Allah did not make a mistake, and that we don't affirm him not knowing. Whatever he legislated for all times. But what happens is that recently with our youngsters is that you're looking at Islam with glasses, and these glasses are tainted.
Yeah.
And they're tainted with liberalism, Marxism, communism, socialism, feminism, minimism, all these ideologies. So because it's polluted so much, when you're looking to Islam, you're thinking, oh, this doesn't look right. But the problem is not with Islam, it's with the glasses that you're wearing.
Yeah.
So we need to clean those glasses. And how do we do that? By educating ourselves. So if we have time for everything, but not our religion, then you can't be surprised if you are starting to get doubts, if you're starting to think things, because you're not given his due right. Allah has rights. The Shahada has seven conditions. Yeah? And one of those is knowledge.
Yeah?
Yeah? So these conditions are in place. Why? Because it's not a merely of just saying La ilaha illallah. Yeah? Even though people differ, scholars of, you know, someone says La ilaha illallah, you know, if he doesn't pray a single salah, etc. That's a different story. Yeah? However, is that once you acknowledge La ilaha illallah,
yeah,
the limbs will take action.
Yeah.
They say every cup sweats what's inside it. So if you have La ilaha inside you and you understand it, it will have action on the limbs. So that's why I believe the religion is for all times and all places.
Okay, so what about in certain, like, people, some people would say in certain scenarios or certain circumstances, like for example, like hijabis in London, a lot of times have a hard time because of people like taking them off or attacking them, things like that.
Yes.
So they'd say, in our time, it's fine to be more, I guess, lenient with it, but also it's important to have the fundamental principle, but it's also okay, I guess, some people would say, is that because you're put in danger, it's okay to either push it off, either take it off, or be lenient with it.
Look, firstly, may Allah bless our sisters who are wearing it, yeah? And I always say this, they're like the backbone of our ummah. It's hard.
Yeah.
It's hard to be out there in a hijab. You're in constant worship. Constant worship. Why? Because the hijab that you're wearing is a form of ibadah. Yeah? As long as your intentions are for the right reasons. If you're wearing a hijab for the fashion reasons, if you stand in front of Allah and say, oh Allah, I did this to you, Allah's going to say you're lying.
Yeah.
It's the same with me. If I say, oh Allah, I was doing dawah, and Allah says you're lying. You did it for the fame, you did it for the money, you did it for this. So that's what we ask Allah to purify our intentions and protect us from corruption. Because the first three people to enter the fire is going to be a person, you know. So the thing is, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless our sisters because they're carrying an ayah of the Quran on their head. Now, just because it's hard doesn't mean it's not for our time, because this life is a test.
Yeah.
So it affirms Allah's, you know, sifat again, because the thing is, Allah has put us here for a test. So you're going to get difficulties. There were people who were persecuted.
Yeah.
When, if I'm not mistaken, Bilal radiallahu anhu came to the Prophet and complained and said, look, we're going through this torture. The Prophet kind of rebuked him. He said, people in the past had their skins peeled off while they're alive. Yeah? So this is the test we have to go through. In this life, we're going to be tested and trialed. Everyone, Allah says, you think I'm going to say, I believe and not be tested? We have tested nations before you. So that is the test. And believe me, it's via these tests that, alhamdulillah, our iman has some kind of effect on us. Because imagine if we had iman, no test, nothing. What did I understand?
Simple, yeah.
It's that conviction, you know, that persecution that you're going through, that gives you that conviction. So be it a sister, be it a brother, whatever you're going through, depends. So the Sharia, if the situation is hard, it eases itself, it expands. Yeah? But if we're living at times of ease, it constricts. Yeah?
Yeah.
So eating pork is haram.
Yeah.
But what if you're dying?
You can, that's allowed.
See, this is the Sharia. The Sharia is not black and white, like, oh, that's it, this is this is the only way.
Yeah.
No, the Sharia is there to cater. But this doesn't mean that we're not living at times where sisters being seen wearing hijab are getting shot in the head one by one. Yeah? So Islam, it's in that way, it expands.
Yeah, see, some people would argue, like what you said, Islam is here to come make your life easier, right?
No, well, easy in what way?
Like, just in general life.
Of course, it gives you a purpose in that context. But going through trials doesn't mean Islam is here to make
you can't use that as an excuse.
No, because the thing is, Islam gives you a purpose in life.
Yeah.
Yeah? And it brings peace to your heart. That's what Allah said in the Quran, that indeed with the remembrance of your Lord, your hearts find peace.
Yeah.
But the thing is, the tests and trials that we go through, they're different.
Okay, I had a question. Sorry, I'm just remembering. Okay, some people, like for example, the Prophet ﷺ, when he first was spreading the message, he did it in secrecy, right?
Yes.
And even when they were about to migrate to Medina, they did it in secrecy. I told Umar ibn al-Khattab, stood in front of everyone and told them, like, he's going to Medina now, right? So, also some people, like, I completely agree with you, and I'm on your side and your standpoint, but I'm just thinking about the hypothetical counter-arguments that people would say, you know?
What would they say?
Like, for example, the Prophet, went in the beginning, because he was afraid and because he wasn't strong and like in an area, he would convey his message secretly, right? Or spread his message in secrecy.
Yeah.
So, like, some people would say, like, in terms of the hijab, would be like, it's okay but I don't see how to do it, like, to wear the hijab in secrecy, but, like, you see what I'm trying to get at? Like,
this is a cop-out. It's a lame excuse, because at that time, there is no scholar that says that there was something legislated by Allah that the Prophet didn't do, yeah, because it was really hard. Do you get what I'm trying to say? So now, we can't use that as a comparison, because over that time, when the hijab was revealed, the Ansari woman would run to get a piece of cloth to cover their hair. So the issue here is, it's a false comparison. Yes, at that time they were under proper persecution, yeah? So they had to migrate, they had to live, yeah? That's why I think in Surah Baqarah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that some people, when the angel of death comes to take their life, and they'll be asked, yeah? And they'll say, we were oppressed in the land. And the angels will say, was not the earth of Allah vast? Because you have nowhere to go to? So these are things, I think they're just cop-outs, in a way. If somebody really believes their life is in danger, really, Islam caters for that. But that depends on a specific context in a specific area. Do you get what I'm trying to say?
Yeah.
So that's why. But I think if people use this excuse not to wear hijab or not pray, these are excuses. I'm sorry. You know, I don't think there's any kind of life endangering.
Yeah, and also I believe that, like, even if a sister, for example, would be attacked, you know, it's better for her to be attacked doing the right thing. And, like, for the sake of Allah, wearing the hijab,
her life shouldn't be put in danger as well.
Yeah.
So it depends. So
I'm just saying hypothetically, you know?
Yeah. So we're not asking sisters if they know their life's in danger, oh, go out there and get... No. So the thing is to be careful, look at the situation, you know, and just try to be safe.
That's it. Thank you so much.
I love it. Thank you.